again, good morning. Welcome to worship on this beautiful Sunday. As always, we like to begin with a choral introit. It is a short song to prepare our hearts, but also asking the presence of God here in our midst. So we've been singing Open Our Eyes this summer, so we'd like to continue singing that song. We'd like to sing two times around. Please remain seated for the singing of this song.
Would you please join me in the call to worship? I will read the light print of the bulletin, and I would like you all to respond to the bold print. Are you hungry for a word of hope?
We come to be fed and nourished.
Are you yearning to see the bounty of God?
We long to see and believe.
Are you ready to witness the power of our God?
We are ready.
Come, let us worship. Please join me in the opening prayer. God of wonder and mystery, you struggle with us when our faith is weakest, yet you do not overcome us. You meet us in our weakness, yet you do not humble us with your strength. In dark nights of the soul, and when the needs of others seem too great, you always stand us back on our feet. When we face overwhelming odds and yearn to find an easy way out, you open new vistas for faithful living. Stay with us when we have need of you, O God, and bless us in our struggles that we might be a blessing for others in need. Amen. Our first hymn is 139 in the hymnal or on the screen. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty.
Thank you.
Here in the house, as well as those who might be joining through streaming from home and other places. I wanted to extend my sincere welcome to each and all of you. It is always the wonderful things for God's people, all walks of life, to be together. We will now go to that time of prayer. But before that, I just wanted to, of course, mention a couple of things. I know that many are under the weather today. I know Heather is, and Ashley also are both out today. But and Ginger, who's been sometimes sitting with Charlotte, but the last Sunday I think she was over on the other side, she said that she has to miss today because she is gathering with her late husband's family to celebrate his life and gather together as a family. So I just wanted to mention that to you. Please remember her for a blessed time with one another. And I wanted to mention welcome to Julie. I know that she had gone through a very difficult time. And sometimes some people physically coming back to this place can be a challenge. So I am glad that you are here. And our prayers that continue to be with you. Any other prayer requests, concerns, or joy? Yes, Larry.
I wish everybody would keep my brother and his son in their prayers. His wife passed away Friday evening at Winchester Hospital from an infection, and they took the respirator off. So. And also keep Jeannie in her prayers. She has bronchitis. She's starting to recover.
Okay. Well, thank you for so Jeannie and Larry's brother and his son. Thank you. Kim, yes. Thank you. Actually, speaking of which, Kim has written us a very nice note for all the family, thanking for the support upon her death of her mother recently. So thank you. Yes, Edwina.
Happy note, my parents' anniversary is tomorrow.
Oh.
I don't know how they've been married 62 years.
Oh, wow.
They have been going strong.
Wow. Happy early anniversary, I guess, to Ed and Carol. Any special plans?
Yes, to stay married.
Well, that too. But I'm hoping you get to do something special. Maybe eating out, or maybe, I don't know.
Yes, we will be eating out.
Oh, wonderful. Okay, good. Carol says she's there. Oh, eating out. So, okay, that's wonderful. Congratulations. Happy anniversary. Yes, I saw a hand from the other side. Yes, Marcia?
My husband Richard is going to be
81
years old.
Oh, happy birthday to Richard, who is, how old do you say, 81?
Yeah.
Okay, well, wonderful. May he have a blessed day. Thank you. Yeah. Any other prayers, matters, or anything that you like to share, the joy, special days, or whatever? Well, if not, I know that you may, some you like to keep it to yourself, which is fine. So now, why don't we together go to God? Maybe open our hearts so that not only we lift our prayers up, but also we will hear what God is speaking to our hearts today. Let us pray. Oh God, we give you thanks for giving us this beautiful day, day of worship, when God's people of all walks of life, that we are able to come together to praise you, pray to you, and yearning to hear your word and grow in our faith. Thank you for being in our lives, guiding our steps each and every day. We trust that even at this moment, you are here in our midst. Our hearts are open to you, God. Speak to us so that we might be strengthened, we might be comforted, that we will continue the journey of faith, not just on Sundays, but all the days of our lives. Now, God, we give you thanks that we are able to share some of the joys as well as our concerns. We trust that you are with us when we are happy, going celebrating special times. But you are also with us when we go through the darkest time of our lives. So here are our prayers, both the ones that were shared as well as the ones that remain in our hearts, that we trust that you hear our prayers and you answer them in your special ways, in your timely manners. We continue to lift up Greenwood Church and each and all the persons who are part of this community. May you continue to provide the next step so that this place will continue to shine the love of Christ in this community and beyond. And we thank you for each and all the persons who are so committed and fired up for you to share your good news with others. Thank you. We continue to pray for this community, country, and the world, especially all the people who are impacted by the weather, impacted by the violence, victims of wars and other injustices. God, we witness so much brokenness in the personal level as well as the world. We need you. We need your help. We need your love. So cover us with your grace that we might stay hopeful even in the midst of dark times. And may you continue to guide our steps, guide our lives each and every day. And may we embrace your grace. Embrace the gift of everlasting life that the Christ our Lord have given to each of us. And may we remain hopeful today and every day. So now the people of God, let us come together and pray together the Lord's Prayer, the prayer Jesus taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory, forever. Amen. So now I'd like to invite each and all of you to stand as you're able, and may we together recite the Apostles' Creed. The words be on the screen, or if you'd like to look, follow with the hymnal, it's 881 towards the back of your hymnal. May we together say what we believe. I believe in God, O Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From then he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. So, we come to the time in the worship when we share special things happening in our lives. First picture that you're seeing is from last Sunday. Miss Tammy filled in for Mr. Steve, who's out of town. He's missing one more Sunday before coming back to continue giving us the children's time. But anyway, thank you so much, Tammy, for filling in. And Kiss had a special song to share with us. And I'm sorry I don't have a picture for that, but that they did a wonderful job, which was such a blessing to each and all of us. So thanks. So, I would have passed the mic to either Heather or Ashley, but both of them are missing today. Well, thank you for all those who came and supported the White Elephant Auction. It was a lot of fun. You know what? I think I come to Tammy afterwards, because she was one of the person who enjoyed the time the most. So, here we go.
Yeah, if you guys ever get a chance to come to the White Elephant Sale, it is so much fun. You come with the intent of spending money, not really getting treasures, but when you get into a bidding battle with somebody, but also if you see Heather or Ashley, if you could give them a thank you, because we were at a meeting and it was brought up that we needed a chairperson for the White Elephant, and my first thought was I can't do it, but Heather and Ashley stepped up and they volunteered to chair the committee so that we could continue with it. So if you see them, make sure that you thank them. And the proceeds go for a wonderful event, the Backpack Ministry. So it was so much fun.
Thank you. So that's more pictures. The picture on the top right, that's the bidding war I'm talking about. That's a sister trying to bid off and competing against another and having a ball for the time being. So. Yes, and the main theme was Christmas in July. So all of course, there's a Christmas tree there, and there's all the gifts are wrapped in like a Christmas wrapper and things like that. And, oh, I think I have to say about this shoes. This is like the coolest shoes ever. Ashley had them all. She said that actually it changes to a more different color, not just, red and green. But, of course, since the theme was Christmas, she just set it to red and the green. But I thought that's so cool. So if you like one, please ask her where she got them. Yes?
We took in $1,171 from the auction. And, you're talking about $1 for this, $2 for that. And so I thought we did real well. Plus, we took in there was a couple that we took in online, so that's not added into that, so that'll be added into that. So we appreciate everyone coming out and bidding and having fun, so maybe we'll be able to do it again next year.
Right. Thank you. So over $1,100. Yes. Another thing was that they had multiple ways to pay. If you wanted to scan the QR code through your smartphone and pay online, you can do that too. So I thought that was so cool that they did. So thank you. So speaking of Mr. Steve, his and his family are having a ball at Lake Anna, and they sent me several photos. So here they are by the lake, I assume, right? I've never been. It's a Lake Anna, so it's lake. Lake. So they're enjoying by the water, use the jet ski and all the boats and all that. Assuming that's the house that the family is staying, as Steve sent me that picture. So great. And one more photo. So this is that's a big group. And it looks like they're having a ball, spending time with one another in a refreshing location. So thank you for sending those photos, Steve and Judy. Oh, this is me. This past week, I had a quick turnaround trip to North Carolina. I wanted to go visit the grave and pick up Joshua. That's the main reason that I had to go down. But anyway, so we just took a trip to North Carolina. And on the way back, we stopped in outside of Greensboro. There's a company called Replacements Limited. I don't know if you know. World's biggest china and porcelain and cutlery and knives and, distributor or collector. But anyway, it's a very well-known company if you like those things. Anyway, we stopped by there, and there's a huge showroom. If you haven't been, I think you might want to check it out, because it looks like, oh my gosh, do not touch that, do not touch, it's kind of, all these like fancy plates, and anyways, we stopped by there because Joshua's uncle Randy works there, so we had a brief but a nice catch-up with him, and we got to see Jeff's sister, Lynn, who lives in town as well, so it was such a blessing that we got to do that, so just sharing a little taste of what it looks like. All right, so, Mr. Walt, would you like to speak about this?
This is the time of the year when the fire department does their second largest fundraiser. And for several years, we've asked the churches that we protect to provide desserts. And the one that provides the most desserts gets to keep the Good Samaritan cross for a year. We've been able to keep it 2 years, and things may be challenging this year. So everyone needs to step up to keep the Good Samaritan cross at Greenwood Methodist.
Thank you. So if you're able to provide the dessert, they want it by 11 o'clock on the day of the event. You take it to the fire hall straight, but the flyer said make sure that you sign in so that they will know that whose dessert it's from and which church that is and all that. So I know, as you know, that we have been having a battle across the against Baptist friends across the street. So yeah, just looking at it, just either of us, it seems like this thing is going back and forth between two places. So anyway, please. On behalf of the fire company, please support this cause. And if you're able to help, please, if you could come talk to Miss Tammy or maybe Walt so that, they might get a good idea of how much we might get. So thank you in advance for all your help. Quick reminder for you all, for those who are in the house, as well as those who might be missing by streaming today. Blessing of the Backpack is next Sunday, August the 13th. Believe it or not, some school system begins school this week, coming week. And Frederick County, I know it's the 15th, is that right? Next week. So it's about time. So we like to celebrate all the children and their coming school year. So please mark your calendar now and for the next Sunday, August the 13th. So if you have any pictures to share, please send them to me directly, or you may use umcgreenwood@gmail.com. So that we can share all the joys and the special things happening in our lives. So I'd like to invite Miss Tracy for a special children's message this morning.
Yay. I'll do my best, Mr. Steve. Good morning, children. Well, guys, today, one of the verses that the grown-ups are going to hear is one that I have always liked. It is from a book called Amos, and it says, "Let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream." And I like that because it makes a really pretty picture in my head to think about water in a waterfall or in a stream. But I got to thinking, water is pretty. It's also powerful. But there are other things that are powerful, too, that we could have in our Bible verse. And I wonder, what makes water a good way to think about justice? So I'm going to get you guys to help me out with something. Leah, I'm going to give you this cup. And Emma, careful with this one. No. Okay, so we said our verse has water in it, and water can be powerful, but there are other powerful things. Leah, what's in your cup? A rock. Okay, can you pour that out in my container? Oh, okay, what happened? What happened with that rock when you poured it out?
It made a hard surface.
it did make a hard sound. It just stayed in that one spot. Okay, Emma, go ahead and pour out your cup. Okay, that's water. What happened to the water that she poured out? It got the rock wet, but did it just stay in one spot?
No,
it went everywhere. It filled that whole container. And I kind of think that's why God wanted Amos to talk about justice and righteousness being like water, because we want it to go everywhere. God's justice and righteousness goes everywhere, but I think he wants us to spread it everywhere too, not just to one person or in one place, but everywhere we go and with all the people we meet. He wants us to be honest and fair and to make sure people are not left out or treated badly. That's right. Yeah, it does look like a real river with water and rock together. So, God, let's go ahead and say a prayer. Dear God, thank you for your justice and righteousness. Please help us to spread your justice and righteousness everywhere we go. Amen. Okay, thank you, guys, for your help with the children's message. You can head to Wiggling Worship.
Thank you very much, Ms. Tracy. I always enjoy a visual prop, so I think that was great. I think it explains the sometimes difficult concept in a way that we can understand, or children can understand. So thank you so much, Tracy. So quick reminder for you, your giving might be mailed to the church. You may use the online portal, or those who are in the house, there's an offering plate placed at the back of the sanctuary. And a quick reminder for you, since today being our first Sunday, we're also asking for a donation for UMCOR, United Methodist Committee on Relief. That does a lot of relief programs domestically, but also internationally. So if you'd like to get that, I think there's one of the plates, there is a sign for UMCOR on there. So if you'd like to, that you're given to go into that cause, place your gifts on that side of the plate. So now let us pray as we give back those gifts to the Lord. Let us pray. Oh God, we give you thanks for the many gifts that you give in many different ways. It is time for us to give back our gifts that you have given us to you. We pray that you accept our gifts, bless our gifts, and use our gifts so that, just as Tracy said, let your justice roll down and be passed and be shared with all the people in this world. Thank you for your love and your forgiveness and the hope that you give. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. So please now join me the prayer for illumination, which you see on the screen. May we pray this prayer together. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, you may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. So today I have selected two passages, and if you are following the printed bulletin, I just made a little boo-boo. So I am going to go ahead and read to you. First set of readings are from the prophet of Amos. The word of Amos, who was among the shepherds of Tekoa, which he saw concerning Israel in the days of King Uzziah of Judah and in the days of King Jeroboam, son of Joash of Israel, 2 years before the earthquake. Alas for you who desire the day of the Lord. Why do you want the day of the Lord? It is darkness, not light. As if someone fled from a lion and was met by a bear and went into the house and rested a hand against the wall and was bitten by a snake. Is it not the day of the Lord darkness, not light, and gloom with no brightness in it? But let the justice roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. And the second set of the scripture come from verses from Isaiah. Here is my servant whom I uphold, my chosen, in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him. He will bring forth justice to the nations. And he said to me, you are my servant, Israel, in whom I will be glorified. Who among you fears the Lord and obeys the voice of his servant, who walks in darkness and has no light, yet trusts in the name of the Lord and relies upon his God? Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases. Yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So we've been talking, sharing this and that from our recent trip in Japan. So I just wanted to continue that one more time. I hope that you enjoy it. But anyway, in summertime, many places have summer festivals. Actually, when I went, okay. This is actually the festival that we got to see in my hometown. But in many places, they do have different festivals for different ways. Anyway, there are many that move to the next slide, please. So during the festival, especially at nighttime, there are so many street vendors that has that sells food of various kinds, toys and other things. Actually, those are the two bottoms ones from the trip that we went. And you see Josh trying to play some rifle game or something like that. Anyway, so it is a lot of fun. And when I was an elementary age child, maybe about 9, 10, something like that, my mother took me to the festival that I'm showing to you. And she bought me a candy apple. Do you know what that is? The apple that's coated with candy. It was red, it was big, and so shiny. I was so excited. I wanted to show it to everyone. Like, you probably would too, if you have, something like that, very special thing. Anyway, so when I was invited by a friend to play, maybe next day or so, right, I took it with me. A friend's mother greeted me at the door. And she immediately said to me, can you go back home and leave your candy and then come back, since that it cannot be shared with others? Oh, that hurt me so bad, because I was expecting something. Oh, that looks like a beautiful and a delicious looking candy apple, right? I brought it, because precisely I wanted to show it to everybody. But anyway, decades later, as an adult, whenever I remember that story, I still have that little ache that I felt, some years ago. But at the same time, though, now as an adult, I understand why she said what she said. She did not mean to hurt me. She wanted to make sure all the food or snacks that was shared can be shared. Sometimes truth hurts. Well, I was thinking about it. The work of the prophet might be the same way, telling the truth that nobody wanted to hear. Today we just heard from two prophets, Amos and Isaiah. Amos was a herdsman, which implies material success, right? Having a lot of sheep, cows, whatever. And he was from the south, southern kingdom of Judah. You need to remember that when those prophets lived, the kingdom was divided into northern kingdom of Israel and the southern kingdom of Judah. See, he himself was from the south, but he was his call was to go to the northern kingdom and share the word that God had given them. Using Dr. Howell, the author of the book that I'm following, his description, Amos had the nerve or the divine compulsion to venture into the North and offer a strident critique of a culture that was prospering. So can you imagine that? You are like not belong to that country yourselves, but you are called to go to there, cross the border, and say how messed up these people are. That's pretty hard, but there's more. He continued, Dr. Howe continues, Amos distanced himself from the professional prophets who spoke only soothing and supportive words to those profiting from injustice and making a sham of piety, end of quote. Can you imagine doing that kind of job? Going to a country that are not of your own and say, you guys are messed up. Them prophets might tell you nice things, but they're wrong. You know, that's hard. In today's text, we heard it. Doomed to you who turn injustice into poison and throw righteousness to the ground. It is as if somebody fled from a lion met by a bear. So they run into the house to hide, and they put the hand on the wall and bitten by a snake. And of course, verse 24, which of course Tracy referred it in her children's message. He says, let justice roll down like waters, and righteousness like ever-flowing stream. So Amos crossed the border and said those words to the people of Israel. Tough job that he got. Any volunteers to replace his place? The second text is from the other section, so-called 2 Isaiah, chapters 40 through 55 of the book of Isaiah. This part was written about 150 years later than the first 39 chapters. So most scholars believe that they was written by a different person, but who had the same call to speak the word of God to the people. So here's a background, little background of 2 Isaiah, right? So in 587 before Common Era, so about 600 years before Jesus' time, if that's easier for you to understand, Jerusalem fell to Babylon. And as a result, many people from Israel, they went to exile. You may have heard the word, meaning that they are leaving their homes and they're forced to live in thousands of miles away in a new place with different language were spoken, different culture, different custom, maybe different faith systems were there. So think about it, if you are in that situation, your major identity were taken away, whether if it's a language, your own culture, or your own faith. Quite understandably, people are discouraged and people are hopeless. They might have felt that their God had completely abandoned them. To these people, Isaiah, the second Isaiah, more specifically, spoke the word of God's comfort. See, his section, chapter 40, begins, comfort, comfort my people. In the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for God. Every mountain hill will be made low. Uneven grounds become level, and the rough places become plain. Then, chapter 53, yes, part of it that we just heard, the text, which is often referred as a suffering servant passage. He was despised and rejected by others. He was wounded for our transgressions and crushed for our iniquities. He was oppressed and was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. One professor writes in her commentary that despite some debates among scholars. The servant referred here is figuratively Israel, God's chosen people. But we know some hundred years later, Jesus' followers, who were well familiar with those texts, made a connection between the servant's anguish and suffering and Jesus' death on the cross. As a matter of fact, even today, we did read this text from Isaiah chapter 53 on Good Friday, remembering Christ's suffering and death on the cross. So, what's common between those two prophets that we just heard? They both spoke the difficult truth. Because of their call, or maybe their conviction, to speak the word of God, they put themselves in a vulnerable place. So in a way, those suffering servants could be their lives as well. Most true prophets were despised. They were hated by the people because they had to carry the very difficult message, a message that nobody wanted to hear. But their call was not just to criticize, you're wrong, the way you live is wrong, and all that. But they're there to remind people that God had not abandoned them. In the midst of the darkness, God would send God's grace, God's comfort, and God's hope, often in unexpected, surprising ways. Indeed, Dr. Howell writes in this chapter, redemption can come and does come through suffering. Redemption can and does come from suffering. That sentence reminded me of the book I read some time ago. It's titled, A Grace Disguised. Have any of them read before? Okay. It was written by Dr. Emeritus now, Jerry Sitzer from Whitworth University in Washington State. Anyway, what happened to him was, in the fall of 1991, a tragic car accident. He was at no fault. The other one came across the road and hit them head on, 85 miles an hour or something. Anyway, 1991, a tragic accident claimed three generations of his loved ones, his mother, his wife, his younger daughter, instantly. He recalls, night after night, feeling so exhausted and anguished that I wonder whether I could survive another day, whether I wanted to survive another day. In another place, he continues, tears came for 40 days. It was only after those 40 days that my mourning became too deep for tears. But after a long journey, he'd come to a conviction that death does not have the final word. Life does. And Jesus' death and resurrection made that possible. His word, having lived such darkness into a little bit of light, speaks volume. He says in another part of the book this way, the quickest way for anyone to reach the sun and the light of the day is not to turn to run west, chasing the setting sun, but to head east, plunging into the darkness until one comes to the sunrise. That's deep. That's a very deep statement. Let's go back to this book that we are following, week enough to read. The Dr. Howell himself shares similar sentiment. He reflects back on his life his ministry, his leadership, and writes this way, quote, "My woundedness is a place where God has spoken to me, called me, and used me. If I have been of any benefit to anyone as a leader, it is not because I am smart," which he is, by the way, "or hardworking, or well-read. It is my weakest weakness, the broken place in me. This is where the grace and power of God does something miraculous for the healing, not of me, but of those around me, in the church, and even the world." End of quote. I love that his honesty. If he were able to say, do something wonderful to as a leader, it's not because he's strong and he's wise, but because he's weak. In the weakest part of who he was, God's grace shone and touched the people in a very special way, and thus changed the life of others and maybe the world. So now think about our own lives. See, I often refer us to be the people of God, one people in Christ Jesus. Yet each of us has different unique experiences, life stories, or backgrounds. At the same time, we also have unique challenges, unique struggles, unique problems that each of us carry. At the same time, we're able to witness. So that tells us we're all one people, but we are unique, different people. That tells me that each of us have a unique ways that God's grace can shine through. We have unique ways to bless this world. Think about it, a unique experience or your unique stories might be able to touch the life of someone. I might not be able to, but some of you might be, because of your experience, your stories, your backgrounds. Our unique experiences and our unique story can and does touch the life of someone. See, using that earlier statement from the book's author, it is our weakest weakness, the broken place in us. That's where the grace and power of God does something miraculous. For the healing of not ourselves per se, but those around us, and those who are at the church or the other community that we are part of. And in maybe little, some simple, special ways, the world. So may we remember, just like God did with those prophets, and just like God did with Jesus' disciple over the centuries, may the same grace of God touch your heart and open your hearts so that in your weakest weakness, in your brokenness, God's grace might shine through. And that grace might touch the lives of those around us. May the grace of God be with you. Continue to guide your step today and every day. Amen. So it is such a joy that we are able to come to the sacrament of Holy Communion. What we would like to do is that we would like to pray the prayer of confession together. And then I would offer a short prayer to bless those elements. And thus we'll take the blood, body and the blood of Christ. So please join me the prayer of confession and pardon together. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we are yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. So now please join me in prayer. Oh God, we give you thanks. And thank you that you have given us this wonderful opportunity, the sacraments, the special ways for us to feel, taste, and touch your love. So as we come together as people of God, just as Jesus did with his friend, taking the bread and blessing the bread, and giving it to the disciple and say, take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. And took the cup and did the same way. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. We come as your children, yearning to receive your love and be reminded that there will be a light at the other side of the tunnel. So that we ask you bless those bread and wine that will become the body of Christ, redeemed in this world, in our own unique, special ways. May we shine through your light. We believe that you are able to do so, not because we are strong, but because your grace can shine through in a mysterious way in our weakest weaknesses. So may we trust in your love and your grace and continue to journey with you today and all the days of our lives. We thank you. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. So we are one people, thus we take from the same bread. Body of Christ, even for you. Blood of Christ, the cup of salvation that is given to all of us. So now, as you feel led, please come. Thank you. Amen. Please now join me in prayer. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. So now, may we, as God's people, sing the closing hymn together, How Firm Our Foundation. If words be on the screen, but if you'd like to look with the music, it's 529 of your United Methodist Hymnal. Please stand as you're able. Quotation, which means God is speaking to us. So when we sing, I'll never, never, never forsake, that is a God's message to each and all of us. So may we always remember that. May the grace of Jesus Christ, love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit that go with you, be with you, and always give you peace. Amen.
means it's strive.